Supervisors for April 3rd meeting. Maybe it's 9 o'clock. Supervisor Chadwick, would you please lead us in the pledge?
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Okay, before we start public comment, I'm going to have a quick comment from County Council, Ms. Long, on using the dais as a campaign speech or using the dais to inform us of information.
Thank you, Chair. I just wanted to remind the board and the public that while we're in this campaign season, this process must remain neutral. The FPPC does put out some regulations regarding what you can and can't do. It makes it very clear that we cannot use this as an opportunity to express or advocate for any campaign proposition or any candidate. It does advise that we don't use what they call the magic words, which are vote for, elect, support, cast, vote against, reject. Those types of words should not be used by the public or by the board when advocating. We're supposed to stick to strictly policy in this room. I'm happy to make aware or make clear if I believe there's something that's violating that rule, but I just want to make it, as we go into the season, just have a little preview of what we can and can't do. So I'm happy to answer questions on this. Again, I wasn't here at the last meeting. I believe that, my experience in the past that the board has been very good about avoiding this. I want to make sure the public's aware they have to avoid it as well, because again, this is not the right opportunity or the right forum to campaign. This is the forum to do county business with the current elected officials, and requesting that we follow the FPPC rules and make sure we have a clean campaign.
All right, thank you. Any questions to Margaret from the board? All right, with that, we will move on to public comment. This time is for information from the public on matters not appearing on this agenda. All comments are limited to 3 minutes and must pertain to matters within the jurisdiction of the board. When addressing the board, please state your name for the record and address the board as a whole through the chair. No action or discussion will be conducted on matters not listed on the agenda. However, the chair may refer the subject matter to the appropriate department for follow-up or schedule the matter on subsequent board agendas.
Kate Graves from Lewiston. We've asked several times for the board to place this on the agenda, the item for elections and the problems with elections and some solutions that the Board of Supervisors has the authority to take care of. We sent a letter over a month ago to the chair and your CAO, and it hasn't even been acknowledged that you received it. We haven't had any contact at all. We published it in way of a letter in the paper of record in the Trinity Journal. And I'm wondering what it takes to get on the agenda for the Board of Supervisors, because we try to follow the law, we ask, and we're not even contacted. And did you get the letter?
I have received the letter. Yes.
Okay, thank you, because I have no way to even know that you received the letter, so I'm glad that you got it. It would be great that you respond. It would be even better if you responded publicly. Shannon White recusing herself from counting her own votes and counting the votes of her competitors and others is common sense. It was no great favor to us. Everybody does that. And it's not enough. It's not adequate to secure our elections. We would like it, the Board of Supervisors, to each of you choose inspectors. And I'm suggesting 2 inspectors each, because it's a lot of time to be there. And if one of your inspectors can't be there, then another could. It's in the code that you can do that. It doesn't say that you have to, but it's definitely in your purview, and it would be the easiest way to make sure that you guys are connected with what's going on with the elections. Also, we'd like it moved down to the basement so it's more secure. Where it is now, the elections officer, well, I guess she would be the incumbent, is her room connects Everybody has keys to that room. Deputies have keys to that room. It connects directly to the outside sidewalk. I think it's the only door there. It's not secured with a keypad. There might be one going up the stairs, but definitely that one isn't secure. It'd be very simple to put a camera in the room so you're not photographing anything you shouldn't, but you can definitely see who's in the room and kind of what they're doing. It's all very simple. It's all very common sense. There's nothing difficult about this. And I don't understand why you haven't contacted us, and I don't understand why you're not willing to do this. Thank you.
Sure.
Listening to the request for a agenda item, I have no interest in seeing this agendized, especially referring to what the SOS has brought forward regarding this item. I think it has absolutely nothing to do with us. It would be an absolute waste of time. So I have no desire to have this brought forward, especially I have no desire to fight the state or the SOS, but I'm sure that other people do. And I do appreciate that we're being told how to do our business, but I would like to let the elections officer do their business and move on. Thank you. That's my opinion. Sticking to it.
Any other comment?
Okay. I'll make a comment. I think that when somebody's doing a good job and there's advice to how to even be more transparent and more, especially with all the allegations that have come forward over the years, even with the grand jury, it's only a benefit to include the public and to build a bridge between the government and the employees and our citizens. So I think it's a great idea. I'm a little concerned that anybody who's writing the board is not responded to, whether I disagree or agree with their point. They should. That's the only way they can contact us, and then to ignore them, I don't understand why we wouldn't respond. Even if we don't want what they want, it's their right to contact, and I believe we have an obligation to respond. So yes, I'd like to see it, and I'd also
like to see this agendized.
Yes, I would.
Okay. And
I would also like to know why we're not responding to constituents, whether they're saying something we want to hear or not want to hear. We still have an obligation to respond.
So what was said last week is not enough to...
I wasn't here, sorry.
Okay. So to clear up, we were given... And now, is this the appropriate time for this? Because we're talking
about... You can respond to public comment as the chair, yeah. But right. Briefly.
So the elections officer came in, said she was recusing, said she's asked Darrell Forslin to step in and run the elections. She said she'd set up talk to the grand jury members to set up grand juries to be in the room, and she had hoped that Darrell would follow through with that. So that's where we're at in the elections.
So would this request go to Darrell, or?
At this point, Darrell is, I don't know if we have a contract yet, but Darrell would be the person running this election. And we would have to ask if he's taken that. So have you done a contract with him yet?
To my knowledge, no, not yet.
Okay. So at this point, we would have to move forward on that request to Darrell.
Well, I'm glad to hear that. And so their further request would now go through Darrell, or would it go through Ms. White?
No, it would go through Darrell. She's given up all her keys to the office and everything.
If I may add, I think she's also requested grand jury members to welcome them to sit.
Right.
I think you just said that. So,
right. But that will be up to Darrell how he designs that.
And we will know that by the next board meeting?
Well, the department has the right to hire extra help as see fit. That's what she's going to be doing, so I'm not sure if that will come through the CO's office, or that'll just be a contract within the elections office. I believe it will be there because she does have the authority to hire extra help up to $900.
And then the other part was, as board of supervisors, when the public contacts us, whether or not we want to be in contact, we need to keep those doors open. That's our responsibility to the citizens of Trinity County. So I would like to make sure that we all do that. And I know that sometimes emails and telephone calls are not the wanted voice or comment to you, but we still need to be able to be open to all citizens.
Okay, thank you. Do you have another comment?
Oh, I just have a clarification. I could be wrong, but I thought a member of their group had reached out to you personally to meet with you, to discuss with you, so maybe that was addressed then, and it wasn't? No? Okay.
All right, let's move on.
Diana Sheen, Weaverville. So it's still sounding like falling under a potential candidate to have control over this, and it is not under her control when she's trying to run. And also, the codes that were in the grand jury report clearly state that 10 people are allowed in the room, and they don't all have to be, I mean, they should be the citizens, they should be of other organizations, and not solely the grand jury. That is a manipulation of the grand jury. And there's a lot to be reread about that report. Thank you.
Kevin Manassian, Hayfork. I know we didn't have any cannabis stuff on the thing today, so I assume this is the time to talk about it. You know, I'm trying to do the micro business. I'm jumping through the hoops. I want to let you know I'm kind of at the front of the lead, and I'm the one running the landmines first, so I want to let you know what I'm running into. I applied for my temporary cultivation license back when they were available, when we had to. It's about to expire. I will have to apply for this cultivation license by the end of the month in order to keep my cultivation, unless I'm able to apply for the micro business license. The problem at the state level is if I pay for the cultivation license, it will not roll over to the micro business license like you guys are allowing us to have here in the state. That's because cultivation is controlled by the California Department of Food and Agriculture, and the micro business is controlled by the Bureau of Cannabis Control. I got letters from them saying that these licenses cannot be rolled over to a micro business license. I also talked with them. They said by getting authorization from you guys to proceed in the micro business licensing process does not give me authorization to operate as a micro business in Trinity or any other county. It simply allows me to proceed in the process of getting the state micro business license. Now I'm in a catch-22 here because to get your license requires I have a fully executed California state micro business license. So I need authorization to get the license so that I can even apply for your license. So like I said, just by you guys giving us authorization to go ahead and get our state license in place means we cannot operate in Trinity County. We will still need to get a license from you for any operations we can do under a micro business. If we're going to distribute, we have to get a Trinity County distribution. If we're going to transport, we have to get the Trinity County transportation. If we're going to do cultivation, we have to have the Trinity County license to do that. The state micro business license does not authorize us to operate in any county without having their specific permit and authorization for that operation. So by denying us the ability to authorization to apply for the micro business license, you're forcing us to spend money on a cultivation license that is going to be included in the micro business license, and we're basically throwing that money down the drain. Anyway, thank you very much.
Kevin, there's a couple pieces of information that you might be missing that we'll address in our ad hoc report. So if you could stick around, we could clarify a couple of things.
All I know is every time I go to the penalty, it will not give me authorization, and it doesn't mean I can operate here. It just means I can get my bonds in place and my insurance in place to make sure I get the micro business stuff ready for when you guys put it out. Thank you.
That's right. Thank you. All right. Anybody else want to speak? All right. With that, we will close public comment and move on to presentation. Item 1.1 was we're going to change the reading of this. We are not adopting a resolution. The state has already adopted a resolution, and Rob Christensen, Senator McGuire's office, is going to present said resolution.
Well, we are very excited. Rick could come up. I don't know if people know this about Rick, but he probably serves as a very part-time employee to our office, where our chief of staff, whenever he has a question, always says, "What's the weather in Trinity County? Let's call Rick. How's the road closure doing on the state highway? We'll call Rick." So it's with no great surprise that the California State Senate is proud to provide you the gold resolution for receiving County Engineer of the Year for the state of California. We are so impressed with the work that you've been doing, and I know that your work here and your work on regional boards has completely changed the dialogue at the state of California when it comes to rural roads. So thank you so much for your great work on behalf of Senator McGuire.
Do some of the things that we have to do that are beyond, above and beyond things that we're trying to get done, and it's extra work, and so, but it brings stuff back to us. Definitely want to thank James Hurlick, who was the FHWA guy. He was the project manager for the Five Bridges project, and definitely without him, I wouldn't have been able to do it and had to push to get it done. And then also I wanted to thank you, the board, for taking risks like we did with the bridges to try to find a new way to get it done. And fortunately it worked out where we ended up with five bridges much cheaper and way faster than we could have ever gotten. And then finally I need to thank my wife because she's my sounding board. Hey, what do you think of this idea? I get a lot of anyways, there's a lot of thanks and a lot of people that inspire me to do the things that I do, and I appreciate everything that everybody's done for me.
Congratulations.
And thank you for coming out, Mr. Christensen, and relaying the senator's thoughts. All right, we'll move on to 1.2, receive a presentation from FHWA, Central Federal Lands Highway Division, Project Manager James Hurlick, regarding the SR-36 project in Humboldt County. No fiscal impact.
About a year ago, or 9 months ago, we started talking about State Route 36 and the big project that's going on in Humboldt County, and the effects that it's having on Southern Trinity County, because essentially anybody that wants to go to the coast on that side has to use Highway 36 to get to Eureka. So it's been a major project because it does involve closures both in the morning and the afternoon, kind of along the lines of what we did with High and Palm Road. But it's also a significant project that the county's been looking forward to and supporting for many years. At that time, you as the board had requested that I have the leadership from FHWA come and make a presentation. This is what's different about this job is most state highway jobs are done by Caltrans, but this job is through the Federal Lands Access Program, which is, it's also known as FLAP. And it was designated back at, I believe, in 2010. And we finally got it underway and it's under construction. James is here to give us an update and talk about what to expect this summer. So I'll turn it over to him.
Thank you, Rick, and thank you, Board, for inviting me here to give this presentation to you. Definitely welcome the opportunity to speak to you and speak about this project to your community as well. I thought I'd just spend a few minutes on explaining who we are. We are part of the U.S. Department of Transportation, part of the Federal Highway Administration, and then I work for the Central Federal Lands Highway Division. Our office is based in Denver, Colorado. We cover 14 states from that area, including California here. And we've had a lot of work in Trinity County, as Rick, I'm sure, has mentioned in the past. We've been working here for 100 years with you, partnering on building the roads in the county. We've also worked in Humboldt County and other counties here in North Cal as well. And so why we're involved, Rick mentioned, the project was originally programmed for the federal, the Forest Highway Program, which I know Trinity County has been a benefactor of for many years. That program went away in 2013, and then the Federal Lands Access Program replaced it in many ways. And so this program is why we're involved with this project. The project is just beyond the Trinity County border. It's on the far eastern side of Humboldt County. The town of Dinsmore is more or less, is actually off the page here. Our project begins when the State Route 36 crosses the Van Dusen River. And as I'll show in the next few pictures here, this is the section of the road that had no centerline stripe for most of it. It was a very windy section of the road. The project, the length of the project right now is 4.4 miles long. We're going to actually shave off some of that when we get done. I'll continue on here. So why does section of road need to be improved? Had basically no shoulder at all in many locations. Very tight curves. There's many times trucks would go off the road or get caught up in the bank. I myself have been caught behind these closures for many hours. And then, as I mentioned, there's no centerline stripe for most of the road. It's a very narrow, windy section of highway. So what will it look like when we get done? I mentioned that it was 4.4 miles. We're going to be straightening it out a little bit, not completely, but a little bit. We'll be shaving off a half mile, so when we get done, it'll be 3.9 miles long. Approximately a 30 mile per hour design speed through there. There'll be a few exceptions to that. We're going to achieve two actual travel lanes that are striped, 12 foot each. Two paved shoulders, 4 foot each. There'll be improved sight distance, improved drainage, and we hope to help with some of the slides and slip outs that are notorious for this area. We are not, we realize we're not going to solve all the problems in the world though, so we recognize that there will still be geological and geotechnical issues going forward, but we hope to address as much as we can within our fiscal means. Here's just a graphic of what the road will look like, visualizing what I just described with the 4 foot shoulders, 12 foot lanes, and basically trying to achieve what a normal road would look like based off of modern day design criteria. Project timeline, we started scoping this project in July of 2012. I myself was part of that scoping team, although in a different capacity. We signed an agreement with Caltrans, our partner on the project, in October 2012. We had a public meeting in December of that year as well. And then the preceding time, we also looked at some alternative alignments. We started to do our preliminary design work. We started our environmental studies. We had another public meeting in July of 2014 and a public hearing as a component of that. Our National Environmental Policy Act documentation, which was an environmental assessment, was completed that time frame, and we had a finding of no significant impact. And also, under CEQA, we had an IS mitigated negative declaration at the same time frame. At that point, the right-of-way activities started. Caltrans was our partner on the project, and the Caltrans right-of-way staff worked on acquiring the rights for the project. They worked with 41 private property owners, and we acquired over 40 acres in roughly a two-year time frame. Right-of-way is completed in September of 2016. Just 2 months later, we issued a tree clearing contract to Steve Manning Construction to remove the trees. That work was done by the end of January of 2017. And then May of last year, we issued a notice to proceed to Mercer Fraser Construction to actually start the road work itself. Here's just the next few slides are some photos of the construction. As Rick mentioned, we do have closures on the highway, which are greatly improving the production. So starting starting yesterday, the road started closed Monday through Thursday from 8 a.m. noon to 1 p.m., 1 to 5 p.m. in the afternoons, and then Fridays 8 to noon, and then 1 to 3. Similar time frames, like as mentioned, Rick mentioned, that we had on the High Palm project within the county here. We've had signs posted on all the major routes leading into that area throughout the region that provide advance notification to road users, as well as using the Caltrans information system to get the word out to people. Here's some photos of the active work. They're not in any particular order, but here's a large fill that we are building. This will be a new section of road that we are building. The old section is going to be abandoned and basically recontoured and revegetated so that when we get done, you won't know that we've been there. This is a photo taken a few weeks after the photo to the top left, and so here we're building that fill up. This is a large culvert here that we installed. Here's some additional photos. Here's a slope that we completed. This has a wire mesh facing to it, which will help provide some stability and help promote vegetation growth. Here's some more excavation work occurring on the bottom right. And then some additional photos as well of excavation occurring. And then I'd like to promote too that we're just not about road building. As part of mitigation for impacts to wetlands on our project, we acquired a 155-acre site, which has over 5 acres of pristine fen and numerous endangered species as well. This is now protected in perpetuity. This site is now owned by the California Department of Fish and Wildlife and will be preserved for generations to come as well. So with that, I'll open up to any questions that you might have regarding the project.
When do you think you'll be completed?
That's a great question. So construction is impacted by a number of things. You have, if there's a shortage of labor, if there's a shortage of equipment, that impacts things. If there's fires, if there's late snow or early snow or rain, all those things are factors into production. That said, it's been a pretty dry year so far, and so we've actually achieved more work over winter than we had planned to. Right now, we have a contract completion date for this fall. this fall this year. Now, that said, if there happens to be immediate, a lot of severe weather that occurs, or if there's is a huge shortage of equipment or labor, then that might impact that schedule.
Absolutely. The last picture that you showed, the set-aside for the environmental, that kind of seems unusual. Is that something that's done often? And where I'm actually leading to is I know that there's been a problem with California Fish and Wildlife. Was there some kind of deal made to set this aside? Fish and Wildlife was stopping you from working for a while on this. I ended up writing a letter to Senator McGuire's office to move forward with Mercer Fraser.
So we had a mitigation site originally identified on the Forest Service property. That site fell through. Unfortunately, there was it was not what we thought it was going to be.
Got it.
And so as circumstances occurred, a private property owner wanted to see his site purchased and preserved for perpetuity. And so he outreached to the CFW, who didn't know of a funding source. And so they outreached to Caltrans, recognizing that transportation often has a mitigation need.
Got it.
And Caltrans came to us as well. And so the two state agencies and us entered in multiple agreements with each other to fund the purchase and preservation of the site.
Okay, and since I haven't heard anything else about it, has California Fish and Wildlife resolved the issue so that you can move forward with this project?
Yes. Okay. Yeah, we have full. All of our permits are in place, and we are under active construction.
Okay, and it's nothing that has to do with you. It was my problem with Fish and Wildlife, and also Humboldt County's problem with it, and the senators. I really should be quiet.
Thank you. All right. Any other questions?
Thank you for your time.
Nope.
Thank you for coming.
Thank you
for putting up with me for a minute.
Okay. We will move on to the consent agenda. These items include routine, non-controversial matters and will be acted upon by the board by one roll call motion. A member of the board, staff, or public may request an item to be pulled considered separately. So, Bob, you want to take it?
Yes, sir. 2.8 and
2.17. Okay. Is Supervisor Morris now? Supervisor Mines, anything?
Supervisor Summer? Nope.
Probably. And hang on, I've got one.
I know you've got everything.
And I will pull 2.10. All right, now I'll accept the motion.
I was pushing you. It's my fault.
No, okay.
I owe you a
any
owe you
staff?
Much.
Any staff polls? Any public polls? All right, now I will entertain.
I'd like to make a motion to accept our consent agenda calendar as presented.
Second.
All right. Emily Morris, please do a roll call.
Supervisor Morris?
Yes.
Supervisor Finley?
Yes.
Supervisor Chadwick?
Yes.
Supervisor Mines?
Yes.
Supervisor Gross?
Aye. All right. On to item 2.18. Excuse me, 2.8. Thank you.
I was not present on March 20th, so I will be abstaining from that vote.
Okay. All right.
We
have the same with Supervisor Mines. Go ahead and
Public.
Wow, I have a tough time today.
No, you're not. I'm giving you a hard time. I'm sorry. Usually it's the other side.
No more questions. Does the public have any comment on 2.8? All right, now we'll bring it back to the board.
Make a motion to approve 2.8, approve regular meeting minutes on March 20th, 2018, as submitted.
Second. All right, all those signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? And abstaining.
Aye.
Two abstentions. All right. 2.10, I will recuse myself off this item and hand it over to the vice chair.
Yeah. I'm at the new target.
Say it again.
I'm at the new target.
Okay, 2.10, find no objections to the issuance of a daily alcohol beverage license to the North Trinity Lake Improvement Association to serve alcohol beverages at the dinner to be held at the North Lake Community Hall and Trinity Center, California, on May 1st, 2018. Thank you. May 5th. Cinco de Mayo, because I reminded of. Any questions for from the board? Members of the public? All right, seeing none, I will entertain a motion.
So made as presented.
Okay, I have a motion so moved by Supervisor Finley, second by Supervisor Chadwick. All in favor?
Aye.
All right. All opposed? So moved. Is there another one you need to speak? I guess that's
it. Nope. That was good.
All right, moving on to item 2.17, approve the allocations of positions listed effective April 1st, 2018, no fiscal impact from human resources.
Thank you, Shelley. I pulled this item, and I apologize that I didn't email you yesterday on this. Basically, is there any changes? Because it just says present what we're doing on all of them, but I didn't know. There was no reference to any changes.
Okay. Right, traditionally, I don't believe in the past that it's been reflected that way, but I think in the future, I would certainly do that. There are subtle changes, and I'm sorry I'm not prepared to, I can try to identify them if you'd like. I can go through each department.
And I apologize that I didn't communicate with you yesterday. Even privately, if you would, I just would like to know if we're adding or decreasing. And on the total, sometimes there's 1.3. We'll start with the. I know that it's supposed to be full time. So is that one employee working full time and extra, or is it one employee and then a part time considered as an extra?
So these are full time equivalents. So that would be. Okay. It could be a combination where the one could equal two half times and then a, you know, 0.3, like a three quarter or, you know, quarter.
Okay.
Of that. Typically in this department you have one full-time employee, and then we have the 0.3 is at this point kind of a 4 to 5 month long part-time extra help positions.
Okay, so it can even be seasonal.
Correct.
Okay.
Correct. And then I can identify some that I know behavioral health reduced a few allocations.
So are those places that we are hoping to fill, are they no longer?
Well, I can't really speak on the department and the methodology of why they're fluctuating. It really is part of their budget, what they can afford and what they can't. What I basically do is I query each department. I show them the current allocation listing that we have as of that time. Every April, we bring this to the board for a new adoption, and we base all of our insurance premiums and OPEB costs based on the, you know, an FTE of each department. So we kind of need a set level to work off of. And
I will present to them everything, any changes that we've had during the year from the last time it was brought to the board. And if there's any changes they want to make, you know, going forward for the new budget year, that's where we reflect the changes on this and I bring it back for their formal adoption. Let's see. I know the road department had some increased positions. I believe they have some increased funding, so they're able to do that. You know, some of these positions have already been approved during mid-year that we've brought to you, so right. Those changes are all reflected throughout.
So the one change that I didn't identify, I might have just missed it, that was the Ed Presley.
That's under Health and Human Services. So if you went to page, well, mine's 11, but mine's landscapes, I apologize. It's under Health and Human Services.
Yeah.
The very first subcategory is called Emergency Services, and you have an Emergency Operations Manager.
So that's it.
That would be the one for that qualification, yes.
That concludes my questions. Thank you, Shelly. I apologize.
Any other questions for Shelly? Any comments from the public? That will bring it back to the board.
I'd be happy to make a motion to accept as presented.
Second. Okay, Chadwick Morris. All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed, same sign.
Thank you.
All right, thank you. All right, so we're not quite to our 10 o'clock hearing yet, so we will move to reports and announcements. Any reports from department heads?
There was good news about a week and a half ago in the omnibus bill that was passed by and signed by the president. There was a provision in there to renew Secure World Schools, our allocation. It was 95% of what we received in 2015. They skipped 2016. We will not get an allocation. The allocation that was approved is for 2017 and 18, where usually the payment comes in January, anywhere from January to March, following the federal fiscal year in which it was given. So 2017 means that we should be getting the payment pretty soon for that, and then we will get another payment 1 year from now. Secure Rural Schools, which is about $1.23 million, I believe, is what I was seeing, less the $88,000 we got earlier this year for forest reserves. Secure Rural Schools is a supplement. Forest Reserves is the actual funds that are given for us based on revenues generated on the forest.
There's a quick question.
SRS, is there any roads included in that since you're just rural schools?
Well, it's schools and roads. It's,
right.
But everybody calls it
Secure
Rural Schools.
Just want to make
sure
roads are included in that, so not just
yeah.
schools.
Yeah,
we,
Secure
we
Rural
talk about
Schools and Roads.
Thank you.
And just to briefly back up on that, it's a split where we split it 50-50 between schools and roads, but there's a little bit that's taken off the top for Title II and Title III projects, which are ones that are determined by the board. I believe it was 15%, but I'm not 100% sure. But anyways, because this fund was not in 2016, we started, and with SB 1 coming, we had rearranged the way the road department budget was done. So this is no longer something that is used to determine staffing and different things, because it's quite candidly, I didn't think it would be coming back. So because it has come back, we are using and are treating it as one-time monies. And we treated that way accordingly in the budget, and the items that are bring forth will be identified as Secure Rural Schools funded projects or purchase of materials or equipment. And being that we're still, you know, with the smog laws, we're limited to using our 5 yards to $200 a year. Those are ones that, you know, we really want to look at trying to replace so that we can have unlimited use of them and really be able to tackle snowstorms and things like that. So.
Go ahead.
How much of this are you going to put toward pavement maintenance? Do you know yet? I obviously you don't know, but you're talking about just buying, spending on large pieces of equipment.
Which yeah, there is a
will last us, but I'd like you to start maintaining some of our roads, especially in Southern Trinity. Mm-hmm.
And there will be some more funds dedicated to do that additional maintenance.
Okay. I'm getting a bumper collection down there. Quite a few potholes and corners, if you would. And yeah, it's funny, but
yeah,
we're going to start getting.
Well, I know
getting. Shelley's going to have to step up and start dealing with stuff.
Yeah, the core of what essentially saving our bacon is SB1, the gas tax that was approved and began in November. That is almost doubling our department's funds. And as you recall, last year I was really pushed down to the very lower limits of what we had available. I mean, it was a very dismal year.
So it's probably time to start letting constituents know what they can look forward to over the next 2 or 3 years with this
yes.
tremendous amount of money coming in and give them a plan
yes.
so
and
that they know what to expect instead of just saying, oh, it's coming.
Yeah, we actually, we're in the process of finishing up developing I call it a road show, but we're having a list of districts. We have 9 districts.
Starting Kenton Palm without me.
Yeah, and Kenton Palm, I've already committed to improving the road between Xenia and Kenton Palm store. We might not be able to tackle all in 1 year, but remember, you might recall earlier we talked about a 70-30 split where 70% right. identified by the program, 30% identified by us. Part of that was going to go to that road to
I apologize for turning this into the District 5 show, but
well, that's okay. It's
yeah. It's
okay. Yeah. But the other good news was, as you know, towards the end of last year, we did go out and spend a substantial amount on asphalt and was able to go out and patch quite a few of the potholes. That will continue on when winter's over here soon. And we'll try to get to a lot more before we actually get back into maintaining. But we will be tackling full floor.
Okay, and you are looking at pavement maintenance, surface maintenance.
Yes.
Help
yes.
our roads, because you've taught me well.
Yes.
You have to maintain them.
Yes.
Okay.
Any other questions?
So, Rick, do I hear that you might bring back to the board just a brief summary, an update on some road work that we can all look forward to, whether it's SB1 funding or secure rural schools or the emergency funding from some storm a couple years ago?
Yeah. Well, the emergency funding we're still waiting for.
Right.
I'm trying to work Central Federal Lands to repair the parts that they had built earlier under a different funding source, but
just keep in mind I want it to be really easy to trailer in a nice yeah. boat into Ruth, you know, from 36, and they're fixing 36, okay. not that anyone likes it, but,
okay.
you know, got to get those boats on the lake.
All righty. And then,
you've made your point, Supervisor.
And just so the board knows, I have to have this next fiscal year's list to you for approval at the May 1st meeting so that we can submit to the CTC.
Okay.
Thank you.
Any other questions? Rick, I have a question. The $1.2 million, is that the total coming out or is that the part that's going to the road department?
That's the part that's going to the road department and that's annual, so it would be about $2.5 million.
Yeah. All right. All right, thank you. Any other department heads? If you need, we will take, before we move on to the next reports and solid waste public hearing. We will take a 10-minute break. We will start promptly at 10 o'clock. I just need three of you. Oh, two more. All right, it's 10 o'clock sharp. We have a public hearing, solid waste, 3.1. Conduct a public hearing. Quiet, please. Conduct a public hearing to consider adopting a resolution that supersedes resolution number 2018-008, establishing a schedule of fees and providing for appropriate exemptions and credits for the 2018-2019 solid waste parcel fee billing, revenue in the amount of approximately $900,000 to the solid waste enterprise fund. Good morning.
Good morning. Diane Rader, Deputy Director of Solid Waste. I need to readopt the resolution for the parcel fee for the fiscal year 18-19, as we found an error in the resolution that was adopted in February. We were missing the land use schedule, which is part of the calculation that we need to get the billing now. So I am requesting that we replace the February resolution with this new resolution, and that is the only change. No other fee changes already.
Okay. Do we have questions from the board?
Thanks for catching up.
All right. Do we have any questions from the public? Or thoughts? All right. With that, we come back to the board.
I make a motion to adopt the resolution to amend the resolution that we adopted.
Second. Okay, Chadwick Morris. This is a resolution, so we will do a roll call if there's no further discussion. All right, go ahead.
Supervisor Morris?
Yes.
Supervisor Chadwick?
Aye.
Supervisor Mines?
Aye.
Supervisor Finley?
Yes.
Supervisor Probst?
Aye.
Thank you.
Thank you, Diana. The quickest public hearing of all time. All right. Were there any more department heads? All right, with that, we'll go to report from the CAO.
Thank you, Chairman Groves. Just a quick report, keeping updated on the amount of licenses that we've issued and the revenues received. So far, we're at 357 licenses issued with revenues received of $2,075,000. So we have exceeded our projected revenues for the cannabis at this point.
All right. Any questions? Yes.
John, I have a question about that regarding the Kingsbury catastrophic spill. Well, it's not catastrophic. Maybe we can put together a letter thanking the cleanup.
Absolutely.
Thanks, sir.
I just have a question for Sue. Yeah. And I don't remember if we mentioned this at the last meeting, but you brought on SHN to help with processing quickly, the CUP processing for some of the licenses that require the CUP. I just didn't know if you wanted to add to that, because I don't know if we made a mention of that last week. Or the
week. I don't believe we have it there in the process of working with six files, three of which, and I believe Leslie is in that she can give a little more detail on that there. Three of them, I believe, are close to completion, and then the other three they're going to be working with us. But if Leslie would like to come up real quick. Mm-hmm.
No, that's correct.
That's it? Okay, I guess I'm correct. So that's where we are right now. But yes, the process has helped us immensely.
And the hope was to, since there's so much work coming through the planning department, to help move those along as quick as possible.
Yes, that's the intention, and so far it's been the results.
So to clarify, this is an outside contract firm that's been hired to help the planning. Okay.
Just a little note on the Kingsbury cleanup. I don't know if the board and CAO is aware that there was a huge effort by people within that community also. So.
What district?
The Kingsbury.
What district? What district is it in?
District 5.
Okay, thank you.
I believe it was a whole community effort.
Thank you.
Okay, any other questions for CAO? All right, let's move on to, this time I will not forget, the members of the Board of Supervisors. Bobby.
So, on the regular meetings prior to this, there's the LCCP. There's some things I'll be bringing to the board as far as retirements and looking for people that will be able to do programs with younger children, Head Start age kids. So we have retirement, we have borderline people probably not going to do it, so we will be needing to really promote that need. TAC last week, or a couple days ago actually, so some changes and real good things actually is probably here now. And also the week of the 19th to the 23rd, I was able to represent Trinity County in Washington, D.C. I had scheduled meetings with senators of California as well as different representatives of Congress. The Senate, unfortunately, it snowed an inch and a half and they canceled. They closed for 2 days, so we weren't able to reschedule. An inch and a half. It was melted by noon the first day, but needless to say, I was not able to, and it was during the time of the omnibus bill. So CAP, the Community Action Partnership committee that I chair, is a tri-county commitment. Glenn, Calusa, and Trinity County work together for LIFE, Head Start, Meals on Wheels, the wood vouchers, these type of things, and it's been stagnant for a while as far as the amount of money. It's one of the few grants, it's a federal grant that comes to the state, and it's local people on the ground that actually utilize the money. So it looks like CAP, with the passage of another bill in Congress, may receive some money with opioids. So I'll keep you abreast on that because there's quite a bit of push from the CAP organization with boots on the ground within our counties to be able to utilize that on the ground in our own communities. Glenn doesn't really have the same situation as we do, so they're looking at it in a different way for the financing. That concludes my report.
Okay. Thank you, Supervisor. Supervisor Morris.
No out of town travel, but I just... The good news we received, as pointed out, the Secure Rural Schools funding came through. In addition, the fire battering legislation went through, something that this board has supported and sent letters, and also our Trinity County Collaborative Group did as well. So that should help some matters. And then just kind of some other federal funding update through NACO. I wanted to give everyone a little bit of a really brief overview. Of course, just the other day, the House passed a $1.3 trillion spending package that will fund the government through September. It provides a $700 billion for the Pentagon and almost $600 billion for domestic discretionary programs, of which the justice programs provide about a $240 million for SCAF, which I don't think we really get much funding for, which is, happens to be a $30 million increase. The burn grants are receiving a $13 million boost, while Violence Against Women Act programs are increased by $11 million. In addition to the Victim of Crime Act, CAP is increased by over $1.8 billion. In the past, we have received funding, the Sheriff Department, on some burn grant applications. Housing CDBG program is funded to a $3.3 billion, as well as a home investment partnership program, and homeless assistant grants are receiving about $412 million. Transportation, as we heard some today already, $2.5 billion in discretionary funding for roads and bridges. The bill also includes a $1 billion increase for Tiger grants. Language is included directing that at least 30% of funds would go to rural communities. The DHSL department, DHS, I'm sorry, the bill includes an increase in number of Department for Homeland Security and FEMA grant applications. Let's see, public lands, as we know, PILT was also funded to the tune of $65 million increase. We have a two-year extension, as you know, for Secure Rural Schools. The final budget retains the Robacher-Blumenauer Amendment, which prohibits federal funding from being spent to prosecute individuals or businesses acting in compliance with state legal medical cannabis laws. FAA extension was extended to until September 30th. HHS received a Healthy Start program and maternal and child health block grant, along with Head Start getting a boost and some extra funding as well. So those are programs, highlights that affect counties. That was forwarded to me from CSEC and NACO, which both, of course, work very closely on to see that funding continues to come to counties. So,
all right.
That's it.
Thank you. Supervisor Mines? Okay. Advisor Fallon?
No out of county travel.
I had no out of county travel, but did have a 2-day meeting with Trinity Management Council. And the bad news is that it's a 90% chance this will be an extra dry year. It's not shocking to anybody that's actually here. So there will be low river flows, and they will be pulling more out of the lake, sending over the hill, unless we have, you know, a good rain event coming, but it would have to be extraordinary rain event to get us even to dry. And that's all I have. So let's move on to the ad hoc committees. State cannabis legislation, any new?
I don't have anything. I don't see anything important coming up.
Just some bills are still making their way, and we won't have more till May or June.
Got it.
I think the last meeting, both Supervisor Mines and Chadwick weren't with us, but I had mentioned that there's a bill introduced to reduce some state taxation on cannabis growers so the industry can kind of get going in this new regulatory world. So that's all on that.
Okay. Permanent commercial cannabis ordinance.
Well, the various pieces are moving along. Today you'll see on the agenda of a Type 9 non-storefront retail ordinance. Microbusiness has hit the Planning Commission once. It will go back likely for some clarification for them for the April 26th meeting, as well as some other ordinances will continue to go through the Planning Commission. Retail overall will also be directed through Planning Commission in the weeks ahead, along with probably the festival ordinance. So, did I miss anything?
The manufacturing will be coming up to the Board of Supervisors. Do we have a date for that?
Likely next board meeting.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
So that has been to the commission. We were waiting some additional information for the ordinance before we brought it forward to the board, and we anticipate that to come at the next board meeting. That covers it.
All right. Any questions? All right. Jail. I'll let the CAO handle that one.
Yes, we've been having communications. Both Rick and I have been, in communications with the state. We are pushing back and forth a timeline as to when the RFP will go out, and working with the state on staffing levels. So that's where we are right now. Everything is moving forward, and progress is being made.
Okay. The 2005 COP refinancing.
That's moving forward. We received two responses to our RFQ. We're pushing for three. It just makes it nicer to have that third response. As soon as we get that, the committee will get together again and choose who they feel is the best candidate and move forward on the refinancing. So I'm anticipating this happening within the next 30 days.
And budget development, I don't believe we have anything.
Nope. I think staff is prepping budget books for department heads to be working on, and then it's a couple months process.
Okay, the wilderness oversight, we'll let John go.
Okay, closest, I forwarded you the email from retired supervisor, District 5 Supervisor Pat Mortensen regarding Congressman Huffman, and I don't quite know what she's representing. Has anything been brought forward from Driscoll or anybody like that?
No, he had told me when I started this he would hope to do it in the next 7 weeks. So
they have reached out to pretty much every other county except Trinity.
Yes.
And Trinity has the largest, as far as I can see, the largest land area.
We do.
District 5 has the largest land area.
Yes, District 5 is the most impacted. I have relayed this on to Mr. Driscoll.
And I have no problem meeting with Pat at some point if you'd like to join
sure.
us. And I really, this almost just needs to wait until after the June or November election cycle, because if Huffman doesn't have any backing for this, it's not going to go anywhere. And we're not going to have anything to fight or praise or accept or worship.
I will say that I think we need to have our stance in here because it will sit on a shelf.
Okay. Until we get ignored. Yeah.
But the possibility, once it does come, it will come quickly and we won't have time to input at that time.
Okay.
All right. So you guys get to see the internal workings there. County matters. These items include non-routine or controversial matters that are listed alphabetically by department. A member of the board or staff may request an item be heard out of order. Does the board have any to magically move agenda items? Anything from the staff? Okay. On to 5.1. Board of Supervisors waive the reading and enact an ordinance amending the Trinity County Code Section 2.36 regarding the Planning Commission, introduced March 20th, 2018, increasing the Planning Department dependent on the number of Planning Commission meetings and field trips conducted. Again, this is, I guess, me.
Second reading.
This, again, is the raising the pay, the 1979 pay of $50 to $100 for all their hard work. And pretty simple. I have nothing else to report on it. Any questions?
No, that a comment.
Okay. Any comment from the public? All right, no, we'll come back. And we'll entertain a
comment.
So moved.
Well, we'll do the comment after.
Yeah, second.
Okay. Morris and family, and your comment?
My comment is Commissioner Frazier and his family, thank you.
Well, I actually make sure that we relay as a board as a whole, we thank all the commissioners and Mr. Frazier. I think it's very difficult, hard work, and people really don't realize how many hours people spend on this, and it's a huge commitment.
And he fully asked for the support of this board regarding K housing. We're going to call it that for now.
Okay.
Got an evil look from her.
All right. Any other comments?
No.
All right. All those in favor? Oh, excuse me. I caught it. This is a roll call.
Supervisor Finley?
Yes.
Supervisor Morris?
Yes.
Supervisor Chadwick?
Yes.
Supervisor Mines?
Yes.
Supervisor Groves?
Aye. All right, 5.2, approve the job description and the salary range at P724 for an agricultural project specialist 1-field aid, $11 an hour from the Agricultural Commission Department for actual hours worked.
Good morning. I'm Shelley Nelson, HR Director, and I have Angela Blanchard from the Agricultural Department with us. So, you know, as we discussed earlier, the allocation listing, this department already has a 0.3 full-time equivalent allocated, so we're not asking for an allocation. But we noticed that the agricultural field aid job description is more experienced. It requires more duties than this four to five month extra help position is actually doing. So we wanted to modify a project specialist version to accurately reflect the limited duties that it envisioned would be doing, which is more collecting pest samples, setting traps. And then we wanted to set it at a salary of $11 an hour. This is a non-represented position. Did not need to go to the union, and we're asking for your consideration, your approval.
Any questions?
Nope.
All right, with that, we'll go to the public. Any comments or questions from the public on item 5.2? Seeing none, we'll be bring back to the board.
Motion to approve as presented.
Second.
Eileen Morris. Any other discussion? None. Call for the vote. All in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, same sign. All right, 5.2 carries. We're going to move on to 5.3 if we can get our computers to work.
I get slowed down.
So we're trying to open up.
It looks like it might be Nova's agenda or their server simply because I'm switching between cell and the local.
Yeah, I can't. I'm directly service. In and I can't bring it up.
Okay.
Could we?
It's on the Terry's looking. Terry, I think, has the actual first screen.
I'm coming up.
Thumb drive.
Yeah, we'll go ahead and take a 5-minute break while we bring up the backup on the side. All right, I believe we've got our computers working for the most part. 5.3, introduce and waive the reading of an ordinance amending zoning ordinance number 315 regarding non-storefront retail license for cannabis. No fiscal impact. All right.
All set? Ready to go?
Waiting.
Oh, sorry.
All right, Ms. Morris, why don't you lead us off?
All right, sorry for the technical difficulties. It's giving me a little rough takeoff for a moment. So, type 9, non-storefront retail. This was, I believe, administratively added in the regulations that came out late last year. As I mentioned in our board report, this license is part of the menu of the micro business license. And I will get to that. I know all the question is on your mind, why is it non-storefront retail? And I'll get to that question. So this is part of the suite of license or activities within the micro business. We had to pull it out separately to create this license so it is available in the micro business license. Overall retail, as I mentioned earlier, that will be addressed at a later date at the PC. We've received a lot of questions about why can't we just do retail at our cultivation site. That's a much more complicated issue, and we thought it would take up a lot more time to address and then hold up a mechanism to get product to the cultivators' customers.
This is usually going to be ordered through a website, phone order, and delivery only. As you'll see in the backup on a non-storefront retail, is not open to the public. The state does not allow you to do that. Bear with me, we just lost our page, okay. So, again, we had to create this license in order to have it fit within the micro-business model that we have proposed to the PC. The micro-business ordinance itself, again, will be back to the PC late in April for further discussion and for the ad hoc to answer some questions. In addition to this being part of the micro-business license, we also have made it available to those who are just cultivators. So there's some very important nuance to understand here. You can be a cultivator and then still deliver your product to your customer through, say, a web-based order directly to the customer, not to retail. That doesn't mean you can circumvent distribution and testing and taxation through that distribution process. So there's two routes to use this license, either through the micro-business license or directly as a type 9 delivery only license. You'll notice this license, if you were to obtain it directly as a cultivator, not as a micro-business license holder, is we have proposed only as a $500 fee to obtain the Type 9 license. The micro-business license in its proposed fashion to the PC has some pro-rated fees proposed in that micro-business license. So I think those are the highlights at the moment. The, as I mentioned again, not to be confused with overall retail, which will be addressed at the Planning Commission at a later date in the next couple of months. So, did I miss anything, Chair Groves, on our
development? I think you explained it pretty well.
It can get very confusing, so I tried to really break it down for everyone involved.
Chairman, I don't want to call you chairman all the time.
You explained it well. It's just that there's the way the staff report's written, which is terrific. There are some supposed contradictions if you're reading it. I don't know if a better way to present it is to just do it a dot point or a diagram or something
well,
like that.
Well, I guess it could have been a flow
yeah,
chart.
Yeah, flow chart. There is. I got a lot of questions about it when I sent it out to constituents and I had some highlights.
So do you have some specific
no,
questions?
No, I have no questions.
Answer,
I get
you're
it.
Clear?
Yeah, and
you're
clear? I was able to explain it to them. It's just...
It is a very confusing in the micro-business.
It's not confusing. It's good. It just needs to be laid out.
Now, the overall structure of the state is even confusing. So this is, again, a delivery-only license. You are still required by the state to comply with all the requirements that a retail license would have anyway. So if you're looking to get this license, make sure you are acquainted with what the state is requiring. Along with micro-business, they too have the requirement of all the other license to adhere to. Whether you're a micro-business or a full-fledged distributor, you still have to follow all those requirements. So any other questions? At the moment?
I find it really confusing.
Yeah, it is.
I shot off a couple of emails yesterday and I don't feel like they were answered. So the micro business is the ECC. You keep saying, you refer to the state. In the state, there is no Type 9.
There is in the regulations, not
okay.
SB 94.
Okay.
They came out with that after, and that's what this is a result of.
Okay. So in the micro business application, there are four things that you have to pick from, cultivation, manufacturing, distribution, and retail.
Three of the four.
You have to have three of the four. And so what it looks like you're doing is making the small micro person, instead of being able to distribute from his site, say like if you had a vineyard and somebody came to a tasting room and then you sold them the wine, they're not going to be able to distribute. It has to be only by an employee who has to then have a license to drive. And then if you have, say, somebody in San Diego, and that person's going to have to drive their medicine or whatever they choose, and it's a $3,000 amount that you have, where we know that the concentrated medicines are more expensive. And so instead of being able to take everything they need, and now the person can't even come to the farm, you've taken away all the agro-tourism because their people are not going to come if they can't taste and they can't, you know. So it just seems like you're taking and forcing the small micro business with the potential to have an on-site farm to be able to showcase and bring in the tourism. You're just eliminating it because now, and some of these places don't even want to cultivate. They might want to be a bed and breakfast where they can have these other things going on, and now you're forcing them out of that. So I don't understand why you're charging people to have a type 9 distribution by driving it only when the micro business application has the distribution, the retail, the manufacturing, and the cultivation. Yes, it has to have at least 3, but you can have all 4. There's no limitations on that. So it just seems like we're going about this all wrong. It's not even, it hasn't even gone before the micro business hasn't even gone through, and now we're limiting it.
All right, once again, we'll go through this again. You are correct, you can do 3 or 4 or all 4. If we were to, doesn't mean that down the road you can't come to your farm and stay and purchase. If we were to wait to have that all through, this may take months to get through. This is a stopgap measure to address a retail component of the micro business. But micro business is really still at the PC, so I don't want to get too far off onto that subject. This is a component of the micro business license that is nested in that suite of activities.
You're taking away. It's a stopgap. It's going to stop it, that's for sure. And I've been promised a lot of things that didn't come.
Okay, you're
so
not.
So to have something come later, I'm not buying it. This is taking away. No, it's not adding to. You're taking away.
Let me give it a try.
Okay. So right now, if we do not pass this, micro business, there is no retail license that they can get. Because you have to have a county retail license for them to retail it. So if we do not pass this or another retail license, then they will only have 3 to choose from. We are trying to move this forward to give a expansion of what they will be able to do and not have to wait for a full retail license, which I think Supervisor Morris is being very optimistic by saying that it'll be a few months. It will be at best middle of summer before that could even get through. So this is an addition, something else that they can do that they do not have a right to do today.
They can't do it without the micro license.
No.
They can't.
No. It's 2 paths. This is part of the micro business activity. If you don't want to be a micro business license holder, but you're a cultivator, you can then lay this license on as a cultivator. You'll still have to go through a distributor and all that, but still have the opportunity to deliver to a customer who, let's say you have a website and they want to order directly. So there's 2 paths that this license allows for some retail activity.
If we passed the micro business today, no cultivator has the right to sell retail in the state of Trinity.
So you're saying that if they have a micro license, you're still not going to allow them to retail? That's what you just said. If we pass the micro license
today, we have no.
But this isn't micro business license. Just remember.
You connected it to it. You're the one that put type 9 license, but recommended by the ad hoc, as an avenue for the microbusiness license holders, Title 12.
And you're missing a lot of stuff, Bobby. So we're trying to, we're not.
You don't see how this is making someone who should have it all bundled together pay for something and why they still don't have the bundle. You don't see that?
If, again, we'll try, if you had a micro license today, we have no ordinance to allow retail. So if you got a micro business, you would have to choose from, well, right now you couldn't because we don't have a manufacturing, but let's just say that was done. You'd have to be a cultivator, manufacturer, and distributor. You have no right in Trinity County until we pass a retail ordinance. This is the first step in a retail ordinance to allow them at least to get some things moving. The micro business, you have to have all those separate issues or all those separate licenses for somebody to get. Right now, in Trinity County, retail is not allowed. This is the first step in allowing some retail.
And then when we bring the manufacturing back, that will also be one of the components, obviously, in the micro business. So all those, these are all separate licenses that make up the micro business for the micro business to function. So this is, again, one of the retail components to make it happen.
You know, I have the instructions right there. And
it's all
combined. It's one license, the person filling it out gets to decide. And so you want to put this thing together on the side and say, oh, we're providing retail. Well, it's already provided in the micro license, and you're the one that combined it with it. So if you want to just, you know, take the micro out because that's not ready, why didn't you just put forward a retail? And why is it delivery only? I mean, we have people that have been...
We just explained it.
So you have a micro license, basically takes all of the license that you want and puts them into one. You still have to follow all the rules unless it's changed in the micro business. But for, like the state. So if you want to be a retailer in your little farm, by state law, you have to have a security guard on business there while you're open. So, for example, you have to do all the same things that they do elsewhere. This, since we do not have a retail ordinance, they cannot get it in a micro business license. You have to have the ordinance to combine and bring in. And those fees will then also bring into the micro business, but we don't have a retail. And if we brought a full-fledged retail forward, I believe it would be July, August before that would be a functional license.
So we're trying to find a stopgap measure to allow that retail activity.
You shouldn't have tied them in. Those who do not hold a micro business license and choose to obtain a Type 9. So right there you're saying that we're going to have micro licenses, but they're also going to have to get their Type 9, which then prohibits them from retailing it other than by the drive. And you don't want to see that? That's fine. If you want to think that this is providing retail for everybody and those with a micro business license, you can go ahead and say that.
Well, what the truth is that a micro business license does not entitle you to retail license, period, in the county of Trinity at this point. I don't know where you think that does.
We don't even have the micro business license, so that is correct. And you're also correct that we don't have the retail component for the micro business, so they can't actually have that component. But neither does anybody else in that county have the retail component. And that is the point. We're tying in the micro business license that should have a component, but now we're eliminating the component and putting it back in as a Type 9, and then they can get the Type 10 license, and all these are also additional fees. Yeah. That have not been set up yet, but may, according to your thing, may be looked at in 12 months, and we might approve them when we've still been looking at the schedule of fees that still haven't come forward. In the meantime, people have been paying their money. I looked at documents yesterday that January 31st of 2018, and he has to pay the fees this week. This is not doing what the cultivators who want to participate in the micro business want. What it is doing is allowing other people to have the license to retail now while the micro business license is still not offered. You don't want to look at it that way? That's fine. But that's the bottom line. The cultivators themselves who want the micro business license, we had somebody come up to talk about that very thing right now. So, you know, don't say that the Type 9 license is a pathway for the micro business, because you're taking away one of the items that they, when it has come before the Planning Commission gets approved, you're taking it away. They don't have the storefront, period.
The storefront retail is likely, as Supervisor Groves pointed out, a much in-depth, lengthy discussion at the Planning Commission. If we waited for that to happen, you could be looking at July before you even have a micro business license ordinance to rely on. This is something to have them have until that is discussed.
So what's wrong with waiting until July, Judy? I doubt anybody. You know, they can just wait it out. What's the big deal?
I guess we could do that.
Maybe we could hear some public comment regarding that.
Mm-hmm. Okay. And you know, we are just trying to have some mechanisms in place.
And let me be clear: the July date
is a guess.
Is July of 2022.
Is a guess, because once we pass an ordinance, then the person will still have to get a conditional use permit, which could take another couple of months.
Right.
But okay. So,
I'm
trying to remember other concerns. Yes, I do have two things to add that we got sidetracked. There were two items that I finally got with County Council to add. So under section number 2B, 4, we say deliveries must be to a physical address and not a post office box. I would like to add the physical address must be the residence of a consumer. And then under 2D, cannabis storefront retail facilities shall be closed to the public. I would like to add all orders must be placed via phone, fax, mail, or internet. So to make sure that
you know, whether they're just lighting the pines and they have a trailer there.
Right, that's a residence. That's where they're residing.
Okay, perfect. Thank you.
That's the two that I've added.
I have a question for Margaret.
Sure.
On the statement that Supervisor Groves just mentioned, you could have somebody at a resort or bed and breakfast, or have it delivered to the application.
The way it is written, yes, you could.
Okay.
John has a question.
No, they're still using it as their residence, though,
for
so that complies, right?
Yeah.
If they're paying a price and a TOT.
Right.
So
right.
That covers it.
Bobby, I apologize. I don't know if we, you know, we disagree on your. But were there other questions that...
Well, on 7 and 8, under the same thing, you have 7. Retailer cannot package or label goods. And then on 8, it says retailer cannot accept, possess, or sell cannabis goods if they are not packaged as they are, will be sold. So it's just down below what he just...
It's 2B, 7, and 8.
Okay, so it's
down there. And I believe these are just right out of state law. Just quotations. I think virtually everything there, except for the physical address, is quotation of state law. So the you mentioned the $3,000, that is state law. The opaque package is state law. This time, the sales and deliveries time is state law.
So do you see the contradiction there in the state law? You don't see it?
Okay, so.
One more time, can you go over it?
Retailer cannot package or label cannabis goods. That's what 7 says. 8 says retailer cannot accept, possess, or sell cannabis goods if they are not packaged, as they will be sold at final sale. So.
But that's the retailer's, you are the cultivator.
Yeah, but it's
so, so the retailer, the retailer has to purchase the items packaged, correct? Is that what that first part means?
So going back to the micro business.
No, we're talking about what you're talking about right now in this paragraph, and that's it.
That's right. Okay, good. You're tying it into the micro business.
So one of your other licenses is going to have to do that process.
In the micro business.
In the, well, even if it's not in micro business, if you're just a cultivator, the retailer, a part of your license doesn't allow you to package someplace else in your license, or when you send it to the distributor to sample and pay taxes, they may or may not do that for you. But off the top of my head, I thought that cultivators can package. I'm looking at experts in the back of the field, and they're saying yes. So in this case, Bobby, as a cultivator, you would package and then move it to your retail.
Right. The retailer simply cannot package the item. They must obtain it packaged per state specifications.
So the way the state has really set this up is that you're going to have like individual sections that moves through.
So on C it says cannabis non-storefront retailers shall possess a valid county cultivation license and shall abide by the regulations established under Trinity County cultivation's orders. So you're saying, again, tying it back into the micro business, that if someone had opted out of cultivating and chose the other threes, that now they're going to possess a cultivation's license?
At this time, we're tying everything to cultivation licenses.
Again, because of a much larger land use discussion would be needed to go without cultivation. And that, again, would take extra time.
So under state law, it's going to be extremely difficult for small non-cannabis producers to even function state law.
D, cannabis non-storefront retailers facilities shall be closed to the public. Again, relating this to the micro businesses that want to not cultivate, now they pay for the cultivation and now they have people come and they can't sell to the public. And I don't think you would appreciate it if you couldn't sell your wine. And I know you have to jump through hoops if people come to your vineyard and now they can't even purchase it at that place.
This does not change that. And I think that's the part I'm a little frustrated in communicating to you. This does not change that at this time, or if a micro business passes with it. That is something that is, as we've said, that the retail to the public is a much more complex. I believe it's going to have a lot more discussion from the public. And this, if we pass the micro ordinance today, you still couldn't have people come to your facility and buy your product.
Right.
And until we pass that, a storefront retail license, that will be the case. And I think what you're saying, it's a very difficult hoop from the state to get through to even do that. So again, between the security cameras, armed guard or guards on premise, you know, closed windows. I mean, it's the state is really cramped down retail. But from this point, to me, the point is, this expands what somebody can do. It doesn't close what we're doing. So, questions, Maureen, Morgan, or should we go? All right, this time we'll open to the public for comment.
My question here, okay, this type 9, you say we're still going to have to work with a distribution person because they're going to have to do the taxes. So I'm going to have to bring it as a farmer to a distributor. He's going to hold it, do the testing, and then package it. And then I'm going to get it back from him and go do my delivery. How does that work money-wise?
Unless you are a micro business.
Which is coming
in the works.
Okay, now this isn't, I mean, passing this today isn't taking it away from the micro business. It's going to be part of it later still. It's just making this part available to us now. So then that way we can actually move stuff somewhere at this point.
Right,
correct.
Okay, but we're still going to have to deal with a distribution person somewhere else.
Right,
under state law.
I like that.
Under state law.
Good morning, Mr. Chairman, board members, and staff. My name is Clarence Rose. I'm from Weaverville. And I just have to comment that the routing and timing of this admitted stopgap measure is very curious. It's very obvious that there's some strategy going on here that even some board members are not aware of. I'd also like to mention, just based on a comment made recently that a few minutes ago, that if you're going to use the definition of residence that you talked about, I suggest you put that tortuous definition in your ordinance. Because when you look in the dictionary, it does not talk about people staying in an RV or a B&B overnight. Residence means where you live. Section 1. You have language in there that says the ordinance prevents this and that. The ordinance doesn't prevent anything. We have ample evidence that with limited law enforcement, regardless of the reasons for that, that rules and regulations are merely words and nothing more. Section 2, does this ordinance amend a land use ordinance? Did this go through planning? Why did it show up on the agenda as a planning matter if it has not gone through planning? Just questions to consider. But here's the thing I'm really concerned about, and it applies not only to what we're talking about today, but the whole process. In Section 3, you have that boilerplate comment, this is exempt from CEQA. To the best of my understanding, there is no significant environmental review taking place regarding cannabis licenses, either at the county or the state level. County licenses are routinely granted without any CEQA. And when the state asks the county, are the county licenses in order? They apparently avoid any mention of CEQA analysis or compliance. And so the county says they're in order, and the state takes that at face value. There is almost no one being denied a state license on the basis of the county license not being in order. Obfuscation and opacity appear to have precedence over sober consideration of environmental effects. I believe this avoidance of seriously considering the environment will end badly. Non-growers who bought into the support the mom-and-pop growers for the sake of funding enforcement mantra are running out of steam as we watch the game of playing with CEQA, the game of playing chicken with CEQA continue. Thank you.
Good morning, John Brower from Junction City, and I applaud this effort. I think it's a great step in the right direction. It's timely, and makes a lot of sense. It's a gentle first step toward retail. It does allow for cultivators to continue in retailing to whatever consumer base they might have via local deliveries. This is vital for our region's medical users. It's vital for the small cultivator that's already done some branding and needs to continue those relationships. It seems that it would allow for, actually it's a question for Margaret, It seems this would allow for cultivators that also have the non-storefront delivery permit to participate in retailing at state-licensed cannabis events like the Emerald Cup or the Chalice Cup. Could allow them to participate in those events, which is huge for brand building and marketing, absolute necessity, and they otherwise wouldn't be able to participate in those events. I do have a couple questions here. So, on page 3, down toward the bottom of the page, item I, non-storefront retailers are only allowed in zones where cultivation licenses, non-storefront retailers are allowed, are only allowed in zones where cultivation license allows. The facility shall not be on prime agricultural soil as determined by the planning director or his or her designee. It doesn't read too clean. Maybe we can clean that up. But also, there really is no land use element to this non-storefront delivery. It's essentially, I think in practice, it's going to be probably a small accessory building on premises where the records are kept and the retail product received from a distributor is stored until a consumer places an order and then it goes out in a delivery vehicle. So we're talking about a tiny little footprint for the actual land use element of this, and it'd already be on a cultivation premises. So it seems that this excluding of prime ag soil could preclude many of our cultivators from being able to participate in this. I applaud the license being good from 1 year from date of issue. I think that helps helps everybody a lot, spreading out the compliance work. And I encourage the supervisors to pass this today. Thank you.
City. Happy to see this here. Thank you for bringing it. I do think it achieves the purpose you're after and that it gives potential micro business holders something to latch onto that isn't manufacturing. It is largely constrained by state law, both for the good and for the bad. It is beyond the local jurisdiction's power to restrict delivery to a private residence. That came with Prop 64. So that is something, no matter how anybody feels, their neighbor can get cannabis delivered to them. And we can't stop that. The rules about packaging and stuff, that comes straight from the state. As Kevin specified, the only difference is no, he, the cultivator, doesn't take it to the distributor. He's not allowed to. Not because you said that, the state said that. The distributor comes and picks it up, takes it, gets it tested, packages it, brings it back. Is that the ideal scenario? No, I don't think so. For that kind of setup, probably micro business works best. But this does do something if somebody's unable to get microbusiness or what, and they can't get their product on a shelf in a dispensary somewhere, at the very least, they can hit Instagram and probably try non-storefront retail. I don't think we're going to see a lot of these deliveries within Trinity County itself. This is us being able to deliver outside the county. You can look on the internet that every retailer that's licensed out there has a website, and they all have their prices on there. And they're selling eighths for $40 to $50. I don't think anybody in Trinity County is going to get on the phone and order a $40 or $50 eighth, because I just don't think that's going to happen. I do think you might see some people make a go at delivering maybe to our neighboring Band counties. It's potentially viable. I don't know that it's going to work, but it's at least something to offer to cultivators who otherwise are sitting on their stores going, what do we do with this? We can't legally send it anywhere. It's a good mechanism. I think it's succinct and it tracks with state law, which is helpful for all of us. And I think, as some other speakers said, I don't think it impacts land use in a sense, especially tying it into a cultivation license already. So I'd encourage you to pass it. And we'll brace for a storefront if it ever comes up, but I think this is a nice thought. Thank you.
Any other comments?
Everett Harvey Weaverville. A couple of unsettled questions. Can I sell through eBay or Amazon? And Amazon will do the delivery. Do I need to be a convicted felon in order to get a license, or do I just get preference? Those are my questions.
I guess the answer is no and no.
No and no.
Hey, Grace from Lewiston. I have a question about who tied it so that you have to have all three of the four. It seems to me micro business, part of the name is micro, tiny. Maybe you want to do just a small component of that. I could see where if people wanted to do more, it's great to bundle it if it saves them money. But if somebody doesn't want to do that broad spectrum and they just want to do a section of that, you're forcing them to pay and comply and be licensed for something they're not doing. And I don't understand why that can't be broke out.
That is the state.
That's the state. Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Hey, you're tough. I'm sorry.
All right. Any other questions, comments? We will come back to the board then.
Can we take a 3-minute break? I want to ask council something. There seems to be a contradiction.
Yes, but I would also before. Council, the verbiage I added on today, would that come back as a first reading next time, or?
So, at this point, you are allowed to make changes to it. The only time it would have to come back for another first reading is if there's substantial changes that require further consulting by staff or planning or something of that nature. I mean, it looks at what the intent is of what you're changing, and I would say at this point you were not need to bring this back for first reading.
With that, we will take a 5-minute break for board to sidebar. All right, we're bringing this back. It's at the board level.
I just have some clarifications, Chair, some things to forward and I have done. So the question was pointed out about ag prime soil. That's not to be confused with an agricultural zone. So I just want to make sure people weren't thinking we were cutting ag zoning out. That may be what I was hearing, so I want to make that clarified for the public. Thank you for whoever, I think it was Mr. Blanco, who clarified that a distributor will pick up from you. You can't take it from there. Important detail. Someone raised the issue of being able to take this license to a festival and be able to, will that apply? I don't know off the top of my head. Because I know we're going to look at the festival license.
The festival license would be necessary. Do not believe this will allow for festival because it has to be delivered
right
to a physical address,
right,
which is a residence, if that changes the place.
But there will be other
other mechanisms in order to do that, correct.
And the
date of issuance per renewal date. You know, we heard that a couple months ago. You'll notice new ordinances will reflect that. We will address that on the cultivation side as another cleanup. But as we move forward, we're going to try and do that as the ordinance gets developed. I think that's all I had. I think I will address the briefly CEQA. The county is working on it. I think, I don't know if Margaret wants to say anything more, but.
Well, I would like to make it clear, unfortunately, the gentleman left and didn't want to hear an answer. The CEQA, as in by state law, from the state, from the county standpoint, is due July 1st, 2019. We will comply with state law and have our CEQA work done by that date, hopefully much earlier. We've already stated that we are working on getting an outside firm to come in and take
what we do have.
We have an outside firm that we will have come in and start doing the CEQA work. And all that entails is going to be tied to the state, tied to us, and we'll have that work completed. So, we've been advised we are following CEQA law and staying on track with CEQA.
I did have one other clarification.
Point of order? What if you have an exemption from the CEQA?
That's not a point of order.
Okay, sorry.
Nice try, though.
Okay.
I have one clarification for, I don't know if this will be of help to Supervisor Chadwick. This ordinance itself is a standalone ordinance, and the only place we mention the micro business is kind of in the backup as an educational reference that this particular ordinance is part of micro business. So the ordinance itself does not have micro business in it directly. It's just micro business is referenced in the backup as part of a component. So. Other than that, I think those were some of the...
And I think there's just a lot of talk about the dollars. We've already stated that if you're transferring your license, if you have two or three licenses and you'd be transferring to a micro, those license fees you've already paid will count against your...
Be prorated
into your micro business. So this is not... Once that comes down the pipe, it won't be in addition to it. Part of.
I think that's what we had.
And there was one change on the verbal, what is it here that I asked council? It's just taking a second to find it. That the physical address be off-site from the cannabis, just to make sure it's very clear. The physical delivery address must be off-site.
From where?
Off-site from the store.
From the person who's delivering it.
Right.
So they literally have to walk next door and not have the same address that...
Yes.
Okay.
We say that a couple of times, but I want to make it perfectly clear. All right, any other comments?
Nope.
Okay. Supervisor Chadwick, any more comments? All right. That I would entertain a motion.
So moved.
Seconded as presented with the changes that were requested.
Yeah, I amend my motion to reflect that as well.
And second.
I will confirm that the amendments would be to section 2B4. I will state the physical address must also be the off-site residence of the consumer. And then 2D, cannabis non-storefront retail facilities shall be closed to the public. All orders must be placed via phone, facsimile, mail, or internet.
Yes. This is a ordinance. If you have something else.
Yes.
I just want to make an overall comment, as this is part, this ordinance, of course, is part of a suite of ordinances that make up our regulatory framework. Without a regulatory framework, this county isn't eligible for grant funding for enforcement. So I think that's sometimes a comments I had to address this last week, and maybe some hints of it here in public comment. Without these ordinances making up our regulatory framework, I think it's a good reminder. Without them, we are not eligible for enforcement money that comes in grant form for law enforcement and other related departments to actually regulate the industry. So with that, I'm ready to vote.
Please take a roll. Okay.
Supervisor Dudley?
It might have changed my mind. I'm not sure. Yes.
Whatever.
Supervisor Morris?
Yes.
Supervisor Chadwick? Supervisor Groves?
Aye. And I'm sorry, that was an abstention. I didn't hear.
Yes.
Thank you.
Was there a reason for abstaining? Do they have to?
No.
I did not too. If you were recused, you have to say why.
Okay. So you don't have to abstain.
Okay.
No need to go on. All right, on to 5.4, transportation, continue, and please, there he is.
Oh, is lunch over? That was pizza.
All right, continued from March 20th, 2018, approve a memorandum of understanding with the city of Tiburon, California, to facilitate exchange of rule 20A, $350,000 to $522,000 in general fund revenue. This was continued due to concerns from Supervisor Finley. Rick?
Unfounded concerns.
We had discussed this item, but just to help the board members that weren't here earlier. Rule 20 is money that is collected when you are billed for your utility under PG&E service area. It's intended to underground utilities. We have not had much success in undergrounding the utilities that we have that are in the PG&E area, but we have $1 million to do it, in essentially, so it sits in a corner where it's not exercised or used. We have an opportunity to exchange Rule 20 monies for cash from other counties or cities that need it for their projects within their jurisdictions. There was a concern that the money was coming from essentially the bulk of the funds from the Downriver and South County areas. And so what could we do to get something back? And I proposed in the staff report that we, since Secure Rural Schools has come in at that time, and then there is a little bit extra need for road work down those areas, that we could use some Secure Rural Schools and set aside to do extra road maintenance in those areas and kind of offset this money that's going to come back in, which I'm hoping will be authorized for the jail water line down the road.
Any questions?
Boy, absolutely not, but boy, you have a lot of use for this money. We'll discuss it later.
Okay. No more questions for Rick. Any comments from the public? All right, we'll bring it back to the board.
Make them, you ready for a motion?
It's up to you. You are the leading one. This affects your district the most. So.
Absolutely. Make a motion to approve as presented and thank Rick for his additional staff support. I'll make a motion and that's it. I'll be quiet. Thanks.
Okay. Second. All right. Any further discussion? All right, all in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? All right, Rick. With that, we go to closed session. Any public comment on the closed session items? Oh, I'm told I have to read them. Thank you, Deputy Vice Chair. 6.1, Government Code, Section 54954.5, parentheses C, conference with legal counsel, anticipated litigation, number of cases 1. 6.2, Government Code, Section 54954.5, parentheses C, conference with legal counsel, existing litigation, number of cases 1. Peeney versus Finley, Trinity County Superior Court case, 16CV068. And 6.3, Government Code, Section 54954.5C, conference with legal counsel, initiation of litigation, number of cases 1. Now, is there any public comment? Closed session. With that, we are going to close. Thank you, everyone, for coming.